Hey, pilots! Welcome to another exciting episode of War Robots Domination, a series of helpful gameplay tutorials designed to help highlight the tactics and strategies that I use to help tip the scales in my favorite game, War Robots. Each episode will feature a handful of battles along with helpful commentary that'll provide insight as to what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. I'm your host, Gotcha Beacons, and I've been playing this awesome game for a few years now, and I've learned a few tricks along the way that I'd love to share with y'all. You'll notice that although my hangar is fairly basic and at lower levels, I have been able to climb it up to Expert League, so I believe that you'll find my tactics will help you do more with less, which could be very helpful with today's economy in the game. I should also mention that this is my second account, so don't let my career profile stats fool you. This is actually my baby account, but it sends a great message to pilots who feel they need to chase the current meta in order to be competitive in battle, because you don't. Wise gameplay can usually overcome any fancy gimmick. A death button is a great example. It can still melt just about any build, and its heritage stems all the way back to near the beginning of the game. It's all about knowing when to use it and how to use it. So, without further ado, I invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episodes while I walk you through my gameplay tactics and share with you my mindset in battle. I hope you find it entertaining, helpful, and fun to watch. I think you will. I'm going to call this battle Packin' Heat, and you'll definitely understand why as we go along here, guys. Enjoy my friends in the background and Status as they play their really cool song, November. I'll put a link to their Facebook website on the description of this episode. So, this is Frick. He's my death button raven. Now, I've got several decks. This is what I call a closed map deck. I call closed maps maps that have a lot more structures and a lot less line of sight. I find that when you don't have a lot of line of sight, there's really no need for someone like Major Payne, who's, you know, basically a long-range support bot, because there's not a lot of great line of sight perches where he can, you know, monitor two or three beacons, and that's what I use him for at the beginning of the battle, because you don't want to mech out, but you don't want to just stand back and do nothing. So you want to be somewhat effective with your, you know, builds, but also, you know, be able to support your team and last for the rest of the battle. Well, you know, on these maps, there isn't much like that. So I've got these. This deck is called a closed map deck, but these are all knife fighters. You got Frick, who's a death button raven who can jump in. He erased quite a few guys and took some guys down. This is Whizbang. He's my Halo Blitz. He's also really, really awesome. He can charge on in and do a lot of damage in a short amount of time. They did do a mechanics nerf, if you will, on the Halos. So these shotgun weapons now, they fire differently. It's a different pace of firing. And as long as you get used to it, you know, they still put out almost the same amount of damage, but it's just different the way they do it. So it's just a matter of getting used to it, and I haven't quite adjusted yet, so I'm not as effective with Whizbang as I used to be, but look at that. He chunked down a whole bunch of guys. So this one, this is Buzzkill. This next performance deserves a formal introduction. His team thinks he's friendly. He looks very nice. The Reds think he's feeble. The Reds should think twice. He doesn't look tough, but don't let his size fool ya. Dismiss this guy's threat, and he's gonna school ya. To see this one fight will give you a chill. It's easy to see why they call him Buzzkill. One of the most underrated builds in my hangar, Buzzkill, my Spark Scourge Mender, quickly proves his value within moments of entering any battle. The long-range top-mounted weapons allow him to shoot over the top of lower structures, much like the General, without risk of return fire. But it gets better. His ability to mend others around him as well as himself unlimited amounts of times in battle make him invaluable in closely matched battles where longevity is the key to victory. But it still gets even better. When activated, his mending ability allows him to weather nearly any firefight while dishing back amazing amounts of damage in close-range fights with his high-output energy weaponry. With his added health module update, Buzzkill seems almost unkillable, even to the most formidable foes. So, take your best shot and bring all your skill. Just be ready to dive when you face Buzzkill. He buzzes, then he kills you. He's my Spark Scorch Mender. You know, he's a lot of fun. He has several things going for him. Obviously, the Sparks and Scourge is a combination. They start off with like a 500 or 600 meter range, but they're not quite potent that longer distance, but they do chip away, so it's kind of a support bot. But also, he's got this mending ability. I just help mend my guy up. Plus, while I'm mending and firing at the same time, I don't take a lot of damage on him. So he's really pretty tough. And I've also loaded the phase shift on him. So now when you're in close with these weapons, you really do a lot of damage. So I tell you what, Buzzkill, he's really kind of an all-around great bot. He's great for your team. He's great for yourself. He can go in and pack a punch. I'm leeched on, but who cares? I can hit my module as I'm doing that. I hit another module. Take that guy out. Here you go, leech. Eat a piece of that. You know, it's a great thing to have. And he finally got taken out. This is a new bot I won. It's called a Nightingale. I call him Sir Nightmare, and he really is. He's got a lot of great features on him. When he's up in the air, he's stealth, and he's healing anyone underneath him, and he's shooting out these suppression fires. But as you see, we've got a 5-to-none beacon advantage, and the pack in the heat really paid off. It pushed a lot of Reds back in their boots, put them on their back heels, allowed my mates to file in behind me too, and you know what, it was really kind of a lot of fun. So, you know, I do have some builds that are packing heat and put out a lot of damage, and you know, I'm all about making sure that we're keeping them blue, and we were, so I can be aggressive as long as my mates are keeping them blue, and that's all that matters. Hey, great pilots on both sides. If you see your name, thanks for the game. Peace out. I'm going to call this battle Final Strike, and you'll definitely see why as you stick around. Hey, enjoy my friends in the background and Status as they play their awesome song, War. All right, guys, we're in Dead City. This is Major Pain. He's my beautiful Zeus Fury. I use an open map deck on Dead City, but you can also do it with a closed map deck. But I found that from here, I can monitor 3 beacons quite successfully. That one in the center there in the bowl, I can see obviously the one to my right there. And I can also, if anyone starts going back to our home spawn beacon, I can shoot them. So it's really, you know, with 600 meters, I can really cover a large area and monitor a lot of different areas. I can drop down to kind of protect myself. I can drop my my body down so my target point isn't exposed. Unfortunately, when you're getting targeted with Hydras, it's not gonna work as well, and I'm probably gonna get taken out a little bit early. I took the healing module off of Major Pain. I put a lock-on on her, so he might not last too long. Well, I'm calling this battle Final Strike. You know, a Final Strike is pretty much at the end of a battle when you're trying to pretty much give that final push. Now, it works best if you're around for that, you know, meaning don't mech out early. So it's important that when you're in a battle, always kind of be pacing yourself. You know, rushing in fast on domination is not the way to play. It's the way to play Beacon Rush for sure, and I've talked about that always, fast forward. But when it comes to domination, this is a more a posture, pacing, positioning, you know, kind of watching the beacon bar, watching the beacon count, see where they are, see where you are, manipulate them a little bit. And, you know, and kind of take it slow and methodical, a little more conservative, and, you know, kind of pace yourself. Now, that was Reaper. He's my Avenger Bulwark. Now I'm taking in my new Arachnid Invader. He's got Sparks and Scourges on him. That is a leech, so you don't shoot the leech. You let him go. Oh, you get friendly fire. My mates are shooting the leech. Don't do that, guys. But it's okay. He's an invader. He's pretty tough. I'm pretty new at the invader, although they've been around for a long time. I just don't run one, so I'm still kind of learning how far he can jump. I don't seem to time my little suppression jump all that well. So if you got an invader and you've been running for a while, you're probably going to tell, hey, GB, you're doing it wrong. Come on now. You got to jump a little further, a little sooner. You got to land more closer to him. I know. I'm learning. Anyway, so we've got this a 3-to-2 beacon advantage now, we're just, you know, kind of cruising along. I made a bad jump there. I didn't get quite close enough to that guy, and so he was able to take out my Arachnid. This is my new one. This is Sir Nightmare. He's my Nightingale, another bot that I won. I actually won this one from just basically filling out a little contest questionnaire, telling them that, you know, how I thought about certain things, and then I also put in, you know, the bot that I wanted if they if they selected me, and they did, and I got a Nightingale. So there you go, guys. Make sure you participate in those things. So anyway, this Nightingale is great because he can heal all my mates underneath him and allow my mates to kind of land, you know, stay a little bit longer in the battle. He's got some lockdown weapons on him. Not quite that good, but they're okay. He doesn't fire when he's in the air. He fires a suppression beam, but he does not fire any of his weapons. So it is not until you land that you're going to find fire weapons. And I'm still kind of, again, learning how to use them. A lot of new bots. But I have been pacing myself. And now he's taken out. So now I'm going to put in Diablo. He's my little Loki. He's my, you know, awesome runner. And seeing that we're at a 3-2 beacon advantage, we've never really lost control of the battle. They were ahead. We were ahead. They were ahead. We were ahead. But also, we've been kind of conservative. And this is why, you know, I've titled this Final Strike. Guys, be around for the final strike. If you have, if you get too aggressive in domination, it's going to not pay off. Because what's going to happen is you're going to mech out. You know, the old saying, you can't cap or kill when you're dead. So stay alive. Well, you know, most football games are won in the second half. You know, War Robots is no different. You want to be around for the second half. And if you are getting too aggressive, if you're getting too crazy, it's not the way to win at domination. It definitely wins Beacon Rush, and I talk about that all the time. But for domination, you just want to be slow and methodical and keep your pacing and not get too aggressive. Make sure you're sticking around. Make sure you don't let the game slip away from you. Make sure you're kind of keeping an eye on beacons. At least get a keep a 3-2 to 2-3 beacon roll for a while and to let them burn through their resources. Take more of a conservative stance, because if you do, what's going to happen is they are going to start burning through their resources, and then you have this nice power play at the end, and you can make your final strike. And that was a nice green banner at the end. All of our guys were in their Titans while the Reds were starting to mech out there, and that allowed us to have a nice advantage over the Reds. So, great pilots on both sides, but I hope you learned that one, guys. Make sure that you are conservative at the beginning of domination. Make sure that you are doing something, but you know, to try to keep your bots alive so that you can be around for that nice final strike. Hey, if you see your name, thanks for the game. Peace out. I'm gonna call this battle Forceful Rush. Definitely stick around, guys. You're going to learn something here. Enjoy my friends in the background and Status as they play their awesome song, Woodish. All right, guys. This is this episode's Beacon Rush battle. You know how I do it? Fast forward. This is the only way to play Beacon Rush. You don't need anything else other than fast, higher DPS bots. I always think of Frick as my first opener to get that neutral beacon. I never expect to get further than that. That's it. I just need to grab that center beacon, that neutral beacon, the furthest one to the center. Then I go to whatever beacon is uncontested. It was this one. So now we're at a three capper. This is what you do, guys. Now, then you're gonna remember this. This is not domination. This is not conservative gameplay. This is absolutely being forceful with everything you do. Always leading toward their home spawn area. Now, I didn't make that one. I'm still learning. This is Sir Nightmare, and he's a good one because he's fast. Fast enough to kind of claw over. Now, you see that Ares down there? He thinks this is domination. He's not moving toward. He's not moving forward. He's just looking for a good place to perch and chip away and do some damage. That is not how you play Beacon Rush. Guys, you need a forceful rush. Always forceful forward toward the forward front. Now, we got a three capper. This is not going to get this beacon, but it's certainly going to disrupt them, and it's going to force them all to come down to this beacon. And now I'm going to go into Diablo. Diablo, not a force at all. What he's going to do, I'm just manipulating the Reds. I'm still doing the forceful rush. I got two beacons here to play with. Now, what Diablo does here, he is a manipulator. He is calling them down. You can't leave this area, guys. If you do, I got you now. I got you down there. I'm going to go over here. I'm going to go after an uncontested beacon. We only need to get one more. Now, see what happened? One of them dropped off just to meet me here because he knew that if I got it, they were toast. So I'm going to make him fly up in the air, put my weapons away. I'm just going to mess with these guys. Right now, I am absolutely just manipulating these guys. I'm giving them a forceful rush right now. You can't leave. If you do, we win. If you don't do anything, no. This guy's got his quantum radar. Guess what you do with quantum radar? Guys, remember when you did this with a stalker? Hey, you know, all you do, you just gotta, you know, kill some time for a little bit. Now I'm gonna pump into him. That's okay. Diablo did his job. Now look, we've got that beacon in the back. We got a four capper. It's a containment zone. They can't do nothing about it. We got them pinned in their home. Guys, the game is over. Now it's just a matter of, you know, watching the kittens. Don't let any of them loose, you know? Don't let any of the kittens scurry away. So we're watching it. We got this containment zone. They can't go anywhere. They can't leave out of it. All of our men are filing in off of all these beacons that we have. This four capper is absolutely going to beat them up. Now, I'm going to keep forcing right onto this guy's face. You know, that's okay. I'm occupying you while the beacons just keep getting bluer and bluer. Woo! A nice forceful rush here, guys. That's how you do beacon rush. You do not sit back and play it like domination. You do not sit back in your range bots and find a nice safe place to pick away and chip away at the reds and get some damage. No. You rush forward, you give them a forceful rush, always pressing toward their home area, and you're gonna get the nice green banners, guys. It manufactures a win every time. If you see your name, thanks for the game. Peace out. Well, friends, that just about wraps it up for another episode. Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed what you saw and were able to take something you learned and use it in battle. I add content to my YouTube channel on a regular basis, so if you like what you see, please tap on the subscription button and then tap the bell to be notified when new episodes are released. Or just click on an old episode and maybe catch another tip that'll help you up your game. Also, Discord is a great way to connect with other amazing pilots, keep up on the latest news, and learn more ways to improve your gaming experience. Without question, one of the best Discord servers out there is War Robots Master Pilots. Managed by some of the best pilots in the game today, it features a robust list of informational, tutorial, and informative channels to cover anything and everything related to this awesome game. So definitely take a moment to click on the link in the description of this episode and check them out. Finally, my goal is to provide you all with entertaining and helpful information that'll help reduce the frustration and increase the fun. So if you feel these videos are helping you, please share them with a friend, someone you think might benefit from them. Well, that's about it for today, guys. As always, keep them blue out there, and I hope to see you on the battlefield. Just make sure you're having fun, because if you're not, you're doing it wrong. I love you all for your support. Play well. Peace out.